official goodbye to baseball.
Some 18 years ago, I left Dayton, Ohio, with two very bad knees. And a dream to become a Major League Baseball player. I thank God that dream came true.
With that, he ended it. It's hard to believe, but there will never be another Mike Schmidt home run. The man considered one of the greatest third basemen in the history of baseball has suddenly ended his career, one that spanned almost two decades and made him a Philadelphia institution, leading the Phillies through the bad times and the best of times, the 1980 World Championship.
Al Meltzer now joins us with more on the retirement of the Phillies' future Hall of Famer.
Well, Mike decided to retire and to say goodbye to a game that he played so well for so long.
I feel like I could easily ask the Phillies to make me a part-time player and hang around for a couple of years to add to my statistical totals. However, my respect for the game, my teammates, and the fans won't allow me to do that. For these reasons, I've decided to retire as an active player.
While one legend was in bloom in 1972, a rookie was feeling his way. That's number 20, Mike Schmidt, in the batting cage. Little did anyone know what greatness lies ahead for Mike Schmidt. He'd go on to become the greatest home run hitting third baseman of all time. In the late 70s, Schmidt blossomed as a home run threat and a fielding whiz. The 70s ended with playoff frustrations, but in 1980, he hit 48 home runs and the Phils won the World Series, their first in over 90 years. Schmidt would win MVP honors in 1981 and 1986, but the Phils would begin a downslide. In 1987, he would surpass the 500 home run plateau and assure his spot in the Hall of Fame.
Swing a long drive! There it is! Number 500! The career 500th home run for Michael Jack Smith!
Last season was the low point, as a rotator cuff problem would sideline him and his career in jeopardy. Mike began the season well, hitting the ball, but the hitting and the fielding has tailed off. He's now making errors.
I've set high standards for myself as a player. I've always said that when I don't feel I can perform up to those standards, that it would be time to retire. My skills to do the things on the field, to make the adjustments needed to hit, to make the routine play on defense, and to run the bases aggressively have deteriorated. Last night, I had a very interesting experience. I challenged my teammates to move ahead with renewed enthusiasm, to face the tough times with confidence, and to believe that things will change. It's now up to them to bring new life to the Phillies organization.
Mike would have liked to have ended his career on top, but that's not going to happen. However, he's going to end up in the Hall of Fame.
No question about it. He's eligible, by the way, in 1995. He did play this year, so it's 5 years after the year that's completed. Let's talk numbers. Just some of the numbers. 8 pages in the Phillies yearbook. 548 home runs. The RBIs. I mean, it's awesome. 10 gold gloves, 3 most valuable players. 8 home run titles, 11 times on the All-Star squad. Mike Schmidt on his way to Cooperstown. About retired, went into the Hall of Fame. Julius Erving, retired, will go into the Hall of Fame. Mike Schmidt, retires, will go into the Hall of Fame. And that was it, the 70s and the 80s. It's all gone.
Thanks, Al.
Okay.
Thanks, Al.
First clues about Mike Schmidt's plan came out this afternoon. People were shocked. They just weren't expecting it this early in the season.
Going to retire tonight?
You got it.
Wow. I'm surprised.
Will you miss him?
Yeah, I miss him.
I think he should stay on a while. I think he's brought a lot to the Phillies. I think he's an extraordinary player, and I think we should keep him a while longer.
But by tonight, the Mike Schmidt story was starting to sink in with Phillies fans. The crowd here at Sportsters in King of Prussia grew suddenly silent when Schmidt's news conference came on the big screen TV.
The Phillies are a first-class organization, and have always afforded me the loyalty and security that few players, if any, will ever know.
Shocked, but yet pleased, because I think he went out the way he wanted to. You know, for him to flounder the way Steve Carlton floundered, and the end of his year wouldn't have been the right way for Mike Schmidt to go out.
I want to cry right with him. It's like seeing a legend just disappear. He was the greatest we ever had in Philadelphia.
Most of the fans I talked to tonight felt a lot of sympathy for what Mike Schmidt's going through, but there are a few who feel he's letting the rest of the team down.
When he signed his big contract this year, that the city of Philadelphia owed him something's what everyone said, and he walked out on the whole deal.
A lot of the baseball fans here have followed Mike Schmidt through his entire career with the Phillies, 17 years, and watching the team play for the first time without him tonight in San Diego was really pretty tough.
There's something missing. Mike Schmidt and the Phillies were almost synonymous. I mean, they were one. Everybody thought of them as together.
Even though he made the decision out on the West Coast, Phillies fans will get a chance to officially say goodbye to Mike Schmidt. He's going to throw out the first ball on Saturday night at the Vet in the game against the Montreal Expos.
And I'm sure he'll be around here for a while.
I suspect you're going
to be cleaning it up. President Bush's proposal to cut U.S. troops in Europe by 20% is met with positive reaction from our NATO. Superstars is over. Mike Schmidt is calling it quits. The Phillies' third baseman had to fight off tears during a news conference tonight in San Diego. He announced he had put on his famous number 20 for the last time. Yesterday, Schmidt drew a walk in his final at-bat. Tonight, he walks away from a career that spanned 18 years and brought him National League records and thousands of fans. Bill Perry joins us now to tell us more about this surprising decision. Bill?
Yeah, okay, Cynthia. In 5 years, Mike Schmidt, the greatest third baseman to ever play the game, will be inducted into the Hall of Fame. That you can be sure of. Schmidt's milestones, three most valuable player awards, 1980, 81, and 86. In 1980, he was the World Series MVP. He won 10 gold gloves. His 548 home runs, seventh on the all-time list. His 1,595 RBI, 17th all-time. His 1,015 extra base hits, 15th all-time. And when Schmidt announced his retirement today in San Diego, it was an emotional scene.
Some 18 years ago, I left Dayton, Ohio, with two very bad knees. In a dream to become a Major League Baseball player. I thank God that dream came true.
Schmidt kidded that he normally only cries at funerals and weddings, and Saturday night at the Vet, when the Phillies play the Montreal Expos, Schmidt will be on hand to throw out the first ball, a chance for the fans at the Vet to say goodbye. At a later date, there will be a Mike Schmidt night, and his uniform number 20 will be officially retired. We will have more on Mike Schmidt later in sports, and I have a suggestion. You might want to crank up that home VCR and be ready for our report. We will show some significant moments from Mike Schmidt's
baseman ever to play this game.
At Ribbit Sports Bar in Cherry Hill, people watched as the Phillies game began with the announcement that Mike Schmidt had left baseball.
It's sad. Well, he had a great career. He'll be remembered for forever. I mean, he'll get on history with the greats.
He knows what he's doing. He's 39 years old. He expected a good year this year. He's not having it, so he's hanging up. That's good.
Well, I think he's a pretty good player, but, you know, retiring all of a sudden, I don't think he should have done that. You know, like Kareem is doing, going around every city getting presents and stuff like that. That's what I would have done personally.
I think he did the right thing. Why let himself go any further? Mickey Mantle did. I'm an old Yankee fan. And Mickey Mantle did the same thing when he felt he was going downhill. You know, it's time to quit.
You can walk away with his head held high and not be washed up and sitting on a bench for a year.
At O'Neill Sports Bar in Queen Village, they also agreed Mike Schmidt had done the right thing.
He's a legend. I grew up worshiping him and Dr. J as a kid, and I was really hurt. I wasn't expecting it. When he cried, I sort of cried with him.
This month, he was 2-for-40 with an infield single, 6 errors. He was killing a ball club. That was it. I love him, but that was it.
And there was also this unsolicited comment.
Maybe Howard Eskin will retire.
Great ball players may come and go, but Howard Eskin is here to stay. At Queen Village, Dan Fiorucci, the 10 o'clock news.
Bill Perry will join us later with more on the Schmidt story, including the reasons he retired and reaction from his teammates.
Player. I've always said that when I don't feel I can perform up to those standards, that it would be time to retire. My skills to do the things on the field, to make the adjustments needed to hit, to make the routine play on defense, and to run the bases aggressively have deteriorated.
But before those skills deteriorated, Mike Schmidt was the greatest Philly ever. Remember him for moments like this, career home run, number 500. Not for his .203 average this year. But Schmidt did hit 6 home runs this season. Here is the last home run from Mike Schmidt. May 2nd, 2-run homer at the Vet off of Houston's Jim DeShays. Schmidt, who also homered in the first 2 games of the season against the Cubs, goes out his way.
Long drive, watch that baby out of here. Home run, Michael Jack Schmidt.
The Phillies are a first-class organization and have always afforded me the loyalty and security that few players, if any, will ever know. For that, I will be forever thankful to the Philadelphia Phillies.
It wasn't supposed to be this way for Schmidt. When he signed last December after his shoulder surgery, Schmidt looked forward to 1989.
I'm optimistic that I can have one of my best years this year. And if that is the case, I think we'll all know I'll be approaching 600 home runs if I do indeed have a good year.
But today, Mike Schmidt, who entertained us in so many ways, knew it was time, and there was reaction.
The greatest third baseman ever to go down in the history of baseball, as far as I'm concerned. He's going to be missed. He's a Hall of Fame player, just a matter of waiting 5 years.
Spent the last 4 years with Mike Schmidt, saw him at the top of his game in 86 with the MVP year. And I admire his decision for what he's done, for what he wants to do now. And on behalf of myself and my teammates, I know we're really going to miss him.
I think all of us who have followed your career will be grateful, not only for what you did on the field, but for the way you lived your life off the field. And I think that's just as important.
Schmidt came out of Dayton, Ohio 18 years ago with a dream to become a major league ball player. Now, it is over.
I thank God that the dream came true.
Comfortable with this decision?
Not having to leave for the ballpark at 2:30 in the afternoon. And being around home in the summertime at barbecue time, you know? You people, how do you barbecue? What is that? I've never done that.
Donna, what will it be like to have Mike home for a summer?
I don't know. I'll have to let everybody know in a month from now whether I'm getting a job or I hope that he gets one.
Donna, what has it been like the last week knowing that Mike could possibly make a decision?
I didn't know till this weekend, and it was pretty hectic. I was afraid to go out of the house for fear that the phone would ring. And it did, and it did, and it did. And then when everything broke loose on Monday, it was rather traumatic for everybody, I think. It just sort of sunk in. I haven't slept very well. I'm a little tired here, Howard.
Donna, you've been through times when Mike was the greatest baseball player that played the game. And you've been through times like this year. What's it like around the house when he's going bad?
There's really not that much difference. I think we avoid talking about baseball. Because, you know, we've done that an awful lot recently. And because there's nothing I can say, and I know it's on his mind, and he's much better off talking with his contemporaries than he is with me about that. So the phone conversations are always filled with what the children have done, or what the pool's not working, or, you know, all those important things in life. And then we just touch on baseball, ask how I did, if I didn't stay awake that night to watch the game, and he tells me, and I said, oh, that's just, you know, and we just quick change the subject.
Until I start wearing glasses and my eyesight goes, I'll always believe I can hit. I'll always believe I could walk up to home plate and get a hit.
A lot of people remember Mike Schmidt always being able to get a hit. If you want to see the all-new Phillies lineup, the game against the Padres will follow, because it's a link to their future. Phillies front office has, well, resisted when Mike has brought up being involved, even in a small way, with the ball club. Baseball people can't believe the Phillies' thinking. Here's hoping the team wakes up before the only tradition left is watching the Philly fanatic. To close the newscast tonight, a look back at Michael Jack Schmidt, a man that sometimes the fans didn't understand, but he did it his way.
The end is near.
good night.
Game, and, you know, they'll get used to it. Somebody will try to take up the slack. Maybe that's one of the problems. But I don't think, you know, nobody's going to fill his shoes.
There's no doubt about that. Don Carmen looking for a good outing. He's facing a guy who's been
times each day for the last week and kept looking for signs of things to make me get these thoughts out of my mind. And this isn't what you want to be thinking. And I continually got the vibrations on the baseball field, around the clubhouse, at the hotel, that it was time for me to walk away from the game.
The team is in San Diego. Ron Burke is there with the Phillies.
After making the decision to give up baseball after 17-plus seasons, Mike Schmidt challenged his teammates to move ahead with renewed enthusiasm and to bring new life to the Phillies organization. And here in San Diego today, Schmidt's former coaches and teammates couldn't help but mention the L word when talking about the third baseman.
I think the big thing is leadership. Somebody else is going to start having to come forward and take over the leadership of the ball club. But, you know, you look at Mike and, you know, I admire the way he went out, because I know that there's a lot of pride in playing the game of baseball, and Mike felt like he wasn't living up to that standard that he had set for himself.
We've definitely lost a leader, that's for sure. You know, to me, the game of baseball has lost a legend. I mean, I feel he's the greatest third baseman that has ever played the game. The only thing I could even compare with the emotion when he let me know would be pretty much the same as if I was standing on first baseline in uniform in Yankee Stadium the day Lou Gehrig announced his retirement.
Well, like Lou Gehrig, Schmidt was the Iron Man of his team for so many years. And now with his retirement, the Phillies will have to find different ways to win ball games. In San Diego, Ron Burke, Channel 10 News.
Hey, by the way, how are the Phillies doing? Well, they're in San Diego and they're playing, and watch what happened. Don Carmen in the first inning, Roberto Alomar, and an infield single in the first. Rip Roberts goes to second. And then Gwynn's
story. Here's sports director Al Meltzer.
Hello there, everybody. Well, today is the second day of Mike Schmidt's retirement, but the first day back in Philadelphia. And again, a tearful goodbye.
Some 18 years ago, I left Dayton, Ohio, with two very bad knees. And a dream to become a Major League Baseball player. I thank God that dream came true. To the young people who might be listening out there, kids whose lives I hope my career has affected, I'd like to say, believe in your dreams as I did. Have faith in God. Work hard. Never give up. And your dreams will come true. Mine did. Lou Gehrig once said in similar circumstances, "Today I'm the luckiest man on the face of the earth." I now know that feeling. Thank you.
We're about to do something tonight that's a little unusual. You've seen Mike Schmidt, and now we'd like to introduce to you a former teammate, Greg Luzinski. Bull, welcome.
How you doing, Al?
Well, this is quite a day, I guess. The end of an era. I suppose it had to come to an end sooner or later. How do you feel about all of this?
Well, I really wasn't too surprised. When they start talking about early in the year, I think before he even signed his contracts, Bill Giles mentioned it. There was mention of retirement. I talked to Mike last year before, I think, on an Atlanta trip, and he had a few questions about retirement, and my only advice to him was, you'll know when it's time. I said, but the one thing that you're going to really miss is, you know, the camaraderie, the routine of being in that locker room. I said, and you're going to miss the game. I said, but you're going to have to find something to do to fill that time, because you can only play so much golf.
Well, earlier tonight, as luck would have it, I talked to another member of this group we're going to talk about, and that's Larry Baugh, and I said, hey, Larry, when Mike said, this is it, did you think about, well, that Booney, Schmitty, Boa?
Yeah, that crossed my mind yesterday when I was listening to Mike talk. And, you know, all good things do come to an end, Al. And I think Mike had a great career. We got to wait 5 years now until we see him again in the Hall of Fame. But He set such high standards for himself that he just felt he wasn't playing up to Mike Schmidt caliber.
Murray, what was it like when he first joined the ball club? You were kind of a almost rookie yourself in those years.
Well, he was a brash kid, you know, when he first came. We signed him out of Ohio there. He came and worked out with us. And he came to work out at shortstop, and I just, I told Mike, I said, I plan on being here for a while. So he went to Reading, and he played a little shortstop, and eventually they moved him to third base. And then once he got to the big leagues, even his first year out, when he struggled, you could see potential there. He hit balls that no other ball player could hit as far as him. You could see everything coming together. He did strike out a lot. He hit under 200 his first year, but he never lost his composure. He was always good with the glove. It was just a pleasure to play alongside him for as long as I did.
All right, now we're going to bring another one into the mix. The Bull here, and the Pope is in Reading. That's Paul Owens, a guy to put this whole thing together. Paul was farm director at the time, and it seems like ancient history now, but you built yourself quite a baseball team there, Paul.
Well, it was, and I had very mixed emotions when I heard it in the middle of the game up here in Reading yesterday that Mike was going to resign and quit. But it brought back an awful lot of memories for me, Al, and certainly with him and Bo and Luzinski and Carlton, and I think it's almost the end of an era that would be hard to repeat again, I think.
Well, Bo, you can join in on this. What were your impressions when you first saw this, as Larry said, brash kid come and work out with the team?
Well, I think, you know, the Phillies had the right idea then. I think it was the Boas and the Doyles first, and then it was Mike Anderson and myself, and then Booney and Schmitty came along, and then it was the Christensens and the Underwoods. And, you know, I remember one thing about Mike, and it was early in his career. It was an extra inning ball game. I think it was like the first series at home, and he had a home run off Gibson in the bottom of the ninth in Veterans Stadium. And when he came around third base, Gibson was standing there and made him run around him. And he came to me and he said, "Hey, Bull, did you see that?" And I said, "Yeah, I guess he wanted to remember you."
Hey, Paul, what are your first recollections of Mike Schmidt, baseball player?
Well, I went to Ohio to see him play a doubleheader with Tony Lucadello against Bowling Green. And it was almost rained out. And fortunately, the game was late starting. But I did see him in a doubleheader, and I had him about seventh on my overall 25-man list that I always went into the draft with. And after seeing his performance that day, as I sat there, I could almost visualize that if we were lucky enough to get him, that with Bo on one side and him on the other, my infield would be set on the right side for about 10 or 12 years, which proved to be right. But he hit a ball over the top of my head for a home run, and I knew he was going to be a great one.
Who switched him from short to third?
Well, he played short that day, but big as he was and cat-like and agile as I saw him play that day, I could just visualize him going over to third base and be a big power hitter and be the great fielder that he was. And with Boa, in my opinion, going to be a great shortstop, I didn't really worry too much past that.
And then you got the Bull out there. Well, we're building the story as we go along. I got a surprise for all of you in a few minutes. But what did you think of the Bull when you first saw him come up with that body?
Well, I like Bull. We tried. Dallas had him out in Huron, South Dakota, and I know he and his dad and I got very, very friendly because we negotiated for about 3 days by phone, and Bull wanted to play ball. And that's what I liked about him. And as soon as I saw him, I knew he was going to be another power hitter. And with those two in the lineup, with Schmitty and him and the young players I had coming around him, I knew we had the nucleus for a team, which proved to be right.
Paul, you've done good. They made history. Take care of yourself.
Okay, I appreciate it, Al.
That's Paul. Now, wait a minute. There's more. No. There's more. The Bull's here, and Paul, we heard from Larry Bo and Mike Schmidt. There's another guy, Bob Boone. We'll hear from him live coming up.
Tonight's Channel 10 Sports Special is sponsored by your local Lincoln Mercury dealer, the Five.
The biggest Philly home run of them all is that one in Montreal. And that set up the Phillies going into the playoffs and eventually winning their first World Series. Oh, how well we remember. All right. You're with us, and Paul's with us, and let's go to Kansas City. Hi, Bob Boone. How are you?
I'm fine, Al. How you doing?
Bob, you are the bionic man. Now, you're not a Philly anymore, but you're still what's left of this group I'm talking about, and you're not only playing, you're playing well. Greg's with us, and of course, Paul is in Reading, and we're all tied into you here.
Well, thanks, Al. It's good to hear Bull and Pope. You know, what Pope didn't finish about that story is when he was thinking and visualizing and seeing Mike Schmidt at third base and moving him from shortstop. The other part of that deal is that he was moving me from third to catcher. And that's probably the greatest thing that ever happened to me, so I guess I owe that all to Mike Schmidt. And we've been dear friends for a long time, and I'm sad to see the era end, but in a lot of ways I'm very excited for to see him get on with the next phase of his life. I'm sure it's going to be an exciting time for him, and I know he's got a lot of relief right now, and he's just the greatest I ever have seen.
By the way, Bull, it's Mike Nichols, so you can talk to Bull if you like.
I know. I haven't called him in a while.
Hi, Bull.
Well, what, does it jog your memory to see him? You haven't seen him in a while.
Well, I haven't seen him in a while, but, you know, he looks in good shape, and it looks like he's probably going to be the next one about 4 or 5 years from now, Bob.
Yeah, Bob, you retired a little late. Bull retired a little early. Paul, what do you think of seeing these guys on the tube here?
Well, it seems like old times, and I hate to say this to Bobby now, because, of course, I tried to sign him out of high school, and his dad, scouting for Boston, said, no, he's going to go on to school. But eventually, Eddie Bachman did sign him, and I told Bobby, I said, Bobby, I got a young player coming along that I said, I don't think you got too much chance at third base. Let's see if you can make a catcher out of you. And, of course, the rest is history there, and Bob has just done an outstanding job.
Did you know early in your careers that this was going to be something very special? Bob, did you realize this was a special time when you first broke in with the Phillies, that all of this great young talent?
Al, I'm having a little trouble hearing you. I think I did. I recognized what Pope was putting together. I think we all did, and you could see it coming together, and we all went through it together and struggled together, and I think that's what made, at the end in 1980, just the epitome of what we had gone through for really a 10-year period in building that to the World Series.
Well, you weren't one of murderer's row, but Bull, you made Mike a better hitter, and he made you a better hitter because they couldn't pass around either
of
you guys.
Well, I think that's part of the lineup. We protected each other. We talked about it. A lot of teams pitch it the same way, fastballs in, sliders away. That type of thing. But, like Bob said, the nucleus was there. The 4 or 5 guys, the 6 guys were put together in the organization, came up through the organization. We played a little bit together in the minor leagues. We went out and got some outside people to help fill in, and, the era began. Some played here a little bit longer than others, but, we were together for a good 10 years, and a happy 10 years, and a winning 10 years.
Bonnie, did you think that Mike was going to be what he turned out to be? I mean, you knew he was pretty good, but in your wildest, did you imagine that this was going to happen?
Well, I'll tell you, Al, I think it was Larry was talking about him coming up and being a brash rookie and working out with the club. Well, the Phillies had an exhibition game in Reading. I was playing in Reading at that time, and I was just starting to catch. And in that exhibition game, Mike played for the Phillies, and he hit the first home run he ever hit in organized baseball or professionally. On a pitch that I called, and I guess I'm very proud of that. I can still remember it. I can remember him coming across home plate and me telling him nice going, and the next day he was playing shortstop and I was playing third for the Reading Phillies.
Pope, come on, these are your guys now. I mean, I can see the smile on your face. You must really be enjoying this, huh? I mean, it's a happy time and a sad time, but you got to think back on all of those wonderful days with Mike.
Well, it was certainly an era that is a big memory, particularly me leaving and almost the end of my career. And just seeing these guys tonight just revives the old 15 years ago.
Well, there's more coming up. Thanks, Pope. Hey, Bobby, you're supposed to retire next year so you can make it back for the 10th reunion, okay?
I'll tell you, Al, I'm really saddened by Schmidt going because he's all that was left for me to hang on to, and I feel very sad about that.
Just remember, you're the last one.
Yeah, you are the last one. Hang out as long as you can. Okay, Bob, thanks a lot.
Okay, Al.
Well, Bull, how do you feel? I mean, what ran through your mind there? Did all of this flash back to you, this 17, 18, 19 years ago?
There's a lot of memories. There's no question about it. I think it's going to be harder for Harry. You know, long drive.
Yeah, right.
You know, he did 500 and how many of those?
Well, hey, Bull, Nice seeing you.
All right,
you look pretty good. You could probably still be a DH, huh?
I just got to get a hold of Mike. I need a new third base coach at school, so.
Hey, there's another Luzinski coming up. There are Boones all over the place. Now, the names will live forever in baseball. We thank Greg Luzinski, Bob Boone, Paul Owens, but there's more because the guy that's building the Phillies of the 90s is going to be our guest coming up. Yeah, what a spot. 500. He finally got there. Another milestone in the career of Mike Schmidt. But as Mike Schmidt retires, you got to think about it as the end of a golden era for Philadelphia sports. Bobby Clark, now the general manager of the Philadelphia Flyers. The Cup. And then there's Ron Jaworski leading the Philadelphia Eagles to a victory over the Dallas Cowboys on a very cold day at Veterans Stadium and on their way to the Super Bowl. Hey, there it is. Tug strikes him out and the Phillies win their first ever. And the great Dr. J, who said it all. The Sixers win that championship back in 1983. So it is, as I indicated, the golden era. All right, but this is today. And the Phillies still have baseball to be played. And Ron Burke is out in San Diego and talking about baseball.
The mood today when I talked to some of the guys, they didn't really want to talk on camera about anything, including Mike Schmidt's retirement, because right now they're focusing on stopping this losing streak. There's so much that they need to do on the field, they say. They're in transition, obviously, because Mike Schmidt is gone, but they have to get a win tonight, and they have to feel like they can win ball games without Mike Schmidt now and stop this losing streak that is now, what, at 6 games. So they want to come out here tonight and make a statement and say, hey, guys, we can do it. We can begin a new era in a positive way.
Yeah.
Well, Mike Schmidt challenged them the other night and said, hey, guys, go out there and do it. And the challenge is now before them, so they just got to go out here and do it.
All right, Sports Director of WCAU-AM, the flagship station for Philadelphia Phillies baseball. Steve!
Yes, sir.
We're going to talk to the man that's building the Phillies of the future. So would you join in with me as we bring Lee Thomas in, who is moving his family now from St. Louis?
I would love to do that. I talk to Lee on Phillies Talk every week. And hi, Lee, how you doing?
Fine, how are you?
Lee, what do you think of all of this camaraderie and class reunion and all of this stuff that triggered when Mike Schmidt announced his retirement?
Well, I think it's a sad time when a guy of Mike's magnitude leaves the game. You know, he's never going to really be replaced. It's always a sad time when a star like him takes his last bow out.
Steve, go ahead. It's your show now.
Lee, the ball club must go forward. You can't be looking back now at Mike's career and the greatness that once was. You need a leadoff hitter. You need a four-hole hitter real bad right now. What's that do to any trades that you may have had in the works that would have involved people like Von Hayes or Juan Samuel, in that they have to be the guys now that are going to provide the runs?
Well, we knew eventually that this was going to happen. I just didn't think it was going to happen quite so soon. You're right. It is the beginning of another time. We're struggling right now. Everybody knows that. I think everybody's trying to hit a 10-run homer and do things that they're not capable of doing at this time. This is just something that you have to struggle through and get through. And you're right. We're still looking for a leadoff hitter. Sammy is probably better hitting down in the lineup. You need a guy to get you started, the guy that can get some walks, get on the base for you, and be a thorn in the other guy's side a lot.
Lee, what does this open for you in trades and moves and what else? When Schmidt finally said, okay, that's it, it's time to start a new era.
Well, you know, when we started this season, I figured that if Mike was going to be here all year, and the way it started out, I thought he was really going to be. And he's the guy who made the decision himself. He wasn't pushed by anybody.
Okay, that was an important guy. I was going to ask you that later. Go ahead.
I think we have to be very careful on what we do because, you know, losing Mike Schmidt's bat, regardless of whether he was hitting or not, I've always said he was a threat in the lineup no matter what he was doing. We're going to have to be careful because we're, you know, that really shorts you in your right-handed power.
Lee, let me ask you a question here. Chris James is the third baseman on an everyday basis for the time being. Chris has appeared to struggle at times in that spot, but tonight he's playing big league first base. He doesn't have Mike's sitting in the dugout watching everything he does. And tonight, Chris James is playing big league third base.
Yeah, I've seen him make a couple of good plays tonight, and that's one of the most important things. He has to feel that he's going to go out there and play third base. He can't be thinking about what Mike has done, because if he does, no matter who plays third, they're not going to have a chance. So Chris is going to have to go out there and be his own self and do what he can do the best and not worry about how he plays.
Who takes over leadership of this team now?
Well, you know, I think we're still kind of groping for a leader. You know, Tommy Herr and some of the other guys here, Howell, those guys have tried to, you know, keep the club going. Right now, we are in a very bad stretch. There's no doubt about it. We've all got to kind of keep our heads up here. And, you know, we've lost three of our starting pitchers. Regardless of how good they are or we thought they were going to be, we've lost three of them. And that's a tough thing to do. We're going to get Floyd Yeomans back here, I think, in within a week or two. And Bruce Ruffin has pitched very well. And no matter how you look at it, Mike Schmidt, what he said in the paper today, hit it right on the head. When the club goes out there and knows they have to score five or six runs to win, you're really hurting before you get started.
Steve, ask him about a trade. Ask him to name some names.
I heard that.
Lee, I ask you this every week on Phillies Talk. I'll ask you tonight on the Mike Schmidt special on Channel 10. Can you tell us anything? Is there a story that we should be reporting tonight, something that's eminent for the Phillies?
Well, you know, there's a lot of clubs starting to call now. I think the Mets, you know, they've lost a few games here in a row, and I think they're getting to the point where they're going to have to make a decision. Are they going to go with what they've got, or are they going to try to shore up their club a little bit? I really think things are going to get heated up. I had two or three calls today, and, you know, you go along, and all of a sudden a couple of clubs hit the right players, the right things. It sounds good, and you do it. So, you know, I look for some things to be happening pretty soon.
Now, you've been on the other side of Mike Schmidt for all of these years. What did you think of him as a ballplayer? What's your evaluation now that Mike is not going to play anymore?
Well, I probably thought the same thing as everybody else, that, you know, he's a franchise player, a superstar, and, you know, he's the one guy on any lineup that you didn't want to have to face with the game on the line. I'm just glad to have been able to get to know him a little bit and to see him and be close to him. Like I have been the last, maybe, you know, the last couple of months of last year and up to now. You know, he's a class guy, and I really wished I could have been around him more.
How do you pitch him? Tell us now. He's not going to play anymore. How did you pitch him?
I think in and out, up and down.
Okay, that's close enough. Not bad. By the way, you were permanently moved now to Philadelphia.
It's been a struggle. You know, we were renting, and now we've bought a townhouse, and so I think within the next 2 weeks I will be permanently here. Now, if we can just get the ball club going a little bit, we'll all feel better.
Okay, thanks a lot.
All right.
That's Lee Thomas, the architect of the 90s, as we go through the 70s and the 80s, and we talked about the golden era, and we talked about everything. But what Mike did in retiring, he triggered all of this, the Bull and the Booney and the Pope. Frankly, it's ancient history now, Steve.
Well, I think what Bull and Booney were talking about in the two-way conversation at Kansas City is right on. There are six players still active in the major leagues today who are on the 80 team, but only Bob Boone is left of that cadre that Paul Owens brought into the organization in the late 60s and early 70s.
The bionic man.
I'm telling you, he looks great.
Doesn't he? We're going to take a look at the highlights of a brilliant career right after this. '48, back in the 2nd of May. And Mike Schmidt has never got another one out of here, as they say. Speaking of out of here, and you got to talk to the broadcasters of the Philadelphia Phillies, and they've been around through this entire career. Whitey Ashburn and Harry Callis.
He never had a hitting coach. He had them, but he didn't ever pay any attention to them. He didn't pay any attention to managers. Well, I guess what I'm trying to say is that whatever he did and whatever he figured out, whatever he sorted out in hitting and fielding and base running, he worked it all out by himself. He never, you know, he never had an instructor.
What do you have to say about Mike Schmidt? What was he? What is he? And how should he be remembered?
The greatest third baseman ever to play the game. There is no doubt in my mind that that is so. Michael Jack not only hit 548 home runs, the amazing thing to me was his great agility and grace for a big man. 6'3", 215, and played third base as well as it has ever been played. Now, a lot of people say, well, what about Brooksy? And Brooksy was outstanding. But no third baseman went to his left as well as Michael Jack and had many, accepted as many chances as he did. And he was also an outstanding base runner. So you're looking at the best third baseman ever to play the game and certainly the best position player ever to don a Phillies uniform.
Harry, one last thing. I got to ask you this. Give me one call of a Mike Schmidt home run right now.
All right.
Go ahead.
Here's the 3-0 pitch from Don Robinson. Swing and a long drive. There it is, the career 500th home run for Michael Jack Schmidt. And the Phillies have taken the lead in Pittsburgh 8-7.
You sound just like Harry Callis. Thanks a lot, Harry.
All right,
okay. Yeah, there was something special about a Mike Schmidt home run. All right, Steve, you handle a talk show, and people call in and they talk about Mike Schmidt, and I've heard them all say, yeah, but he never got the hit that really counted, or he only hit home runs when no one was on base, and all of the things, and he had this love-hate affair with the Philadelphia fans almost from day one, and that's probably because he made the game look too easy. At least I thought that's what it was.
Well, I think that's a piece of it, Al. You know, we really haven't had a lot of that in the last 5 years. Starting in about 81 or 82, really, people stopped criticizing Mike Schmidt, stopped calling the show and saying things like, hey, the guy never hits a home run when it counts. I used to say, what are you talking about? The guy hit 45 home runs last year, led the league in game-winning RBIs. Some of those fellas had a count.
But he was the best I ever saw playing that position, certainly, and they call him the greatest Philly of them all. There's no question about that. But I was always a little bit disturbed by the fact that as Ted Williams in Boston, we both know that story, was not appreciated by the media or the fans, Mike had that problem for a long, long time. And in some cases, I think he lit the fuse himself.
No question. Mike had a propensity to open up his big mouth whenever he thought that the people here in Philadelphia wouldn't get to hear about
it. Oh, sure.
Mike never got a grasp of what wire services were and what they actually did. And that if you talk to a writer in Montreal, it's going to be in the newspapers in Philadelphia the next morning. Mm-hmm. The words are barely out of your mouth, and it's on the wire. It happened again this spring down in Clearwater. He did that cheesesteak comment down in Clearwater, and he hated himself the next day, kicked himself all over the next day. He forgot. He talked to a writer from Tampa, didn't think anybody in Philadelphia would find out about it. It was in all the papers the next day.
You know what he always wanted to do when he hit that 500th, and he chugged around the base and all that. I said to him, you know, a couple of years ago, I said, Mike, come on, when you hit one out of the ballpark, give me a Reggie or give me something. He said, yeah. But it just wasn't in him. I mean, that was it. Joe Cool, and no matter what was inside, it was going to be that way outside.
Well, somebody called the show tonight. We took a lot of calls, people that wanted to have some final words to Mike. And somebody called and said, just like Sinatra said, this guy broke into this game doing it his way. He left the game doing it his way, and he did it his way every time he walked onto the field. People expected him to be a leader. When is this guy? He's the veteran. When's he going to take charge? When's he going to be the straw that stirs the drink? They wanted him to be Larry Boa. Schmidt, he could never be Larry Boa. He was only Mike Schmidt. And he was never a rah-rah guy. He's still a quiet guy. Get him talking baseball, talk your ear off. But it wasn't his personality. They made him the team captain 1 year. It almost broke him emotionally. He didn't want it, hated being the team captain.
Figure. Well, he's going to go to the Hall of Fame in 1995.
You and I are going to be there.
And we'll be there to welcome him in. Steve Carlton's number will be retired, and I don't know the exact date. Have they talked about the date yet to retire number 20?
Yes, that's going to come up in midsummer this year. You did not ask me to bring that into the studio with me, so I did not. They will probably wait till next year to give Mike Schmidt a night and to officially retire his number. But we know nobody's going to wear that number.
And the 10th reunion of the 1980 team. As we said, highlights of a career that may never happen again in this town. Mike Schmidt. Let's watch.
Our thanks to Steve, the Bull, the Pope, Booney, and above all, our thanks for everything, Mike Schmidt. So long, everybody.
Of Prism Sports.
Tonight, the ultimate tribute to the greatest player in Phillies history.
They told me to, you know, get rid of Mike Schmidt, send him back to the minor leagues, and I stuck with them.
Pitch to Schmidt. Long drive to left field. He buried it.
Winning baseball in Philadelphia was a new thing to this town, and the town loved it, and the young players who had experienced the lows prior to that year started to love it, too.
And he takes a shot at it. There it goes. It is out of here. Michael Jack Schmidt with number 500. What a spot.
Lou Gehrig once said in similar circumstances, "Today I'm the luckiest man on the face of the earth." I now know that feeling. Thank you.
It was always my dream to have my number retired with the Phillies in first place. You know what I mean?
Prism Sports presents... Philadelphia Phillies Baseball. Tonight, the Phillies take on the Atlanta Braves. Live from a sold-out Veterans Stadium, welcome to a tribute to Mike Schmidt. By Michael Jack and Gary Maddox. Mike, of course, waiting in the wings for a very big moment in his life, and Gary Maddox, his very close friend and former teammate, obviously, going to be a part of the ceremonies. The ceremonies are much kind of like a playoff game or a World Series right now. We have over 60,000 fans in the Vet, and there's that certain atmosphere that you can sense that goes with really special times. Everyone is kind of asked from time to time, what does Mike Schmidt mean to you, or what do you remember most about him? Well, in my case, going back to a newspaper career and then later on in broadcasting and now working with Mike, I think the one thing that will always stand out is that he was always there and available, often under very trying times, whenever I needed him, whether it was for an interview, a conversation, or maybe just some insights into what was going on. Well, enough has been said by me, and it's time now that we get on with the festivities of the evening. And to get us going, let's go now to public address announcer Dan Baker.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to beautiful Philadelphia Veterans Stadium, where tonight the National League presents the Philadelphia Phillies and the Atlanta Braves. But ladies and gentlemen, prior to the start of tonight's National League game, it's time for a very special moment in Phillies baseball history. Your master of ceremonies down on the field has called most of number 20's 548 career homers in that unique style of his that combines anticipation and excitement in his brilliant signature description. Ladies and gentlemen, the radio and television play-by-play voice of the Philadelphia Phillies, Harry Callis.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Balmy Veterans Stadium. But I know that the significance of this evening will warm your hearts, your souls, and your bodies. Because tonight we have gathered to pay tribute
to the greatest third baseman who ever played this beautiful game. I can't tell you what a privilege it has been for us to follow the entire career of Mike Schmidt in Philadelphia. And what a personal thrill for me, for over 500 times, to say, swing and a long drive, out of here, Michael Jack Schmidt. The MVP awards, the Gold Glove awards, the 10-time the player of the decade for the 1980s. Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Schmidt arrived in Philadelphia in 1972. Now arriving in the stadium from the right field bullpen in a 1972 Oldsmobile convertible, the greatest Phillies player ever, the best third baseman in the history of the game, Michael Jack Schmidt. Gentlemen, from Dayton, Ohio, Michael Jack's parents, Lois and Jack Schmidt. Mike's mom and dad, Lois and Jack Schmidt from Dayton, Ohio. His sister, Sally Mart, and her husband, Ron, also from Dayton, Ohio. Mike's lovely wife of 16 years, Donna Schmidt, escorted by Phillies president Bill Giles. Mike and Donna's 11-year-old daughter, the beautiful Jessica. And their 9-year-old son, who got a game ball for his exploits on the field last week in Little League, 9-year-old Jonathan. Joining the celebration with us tonight, the Honorable Mayor of Philadelphia, Wilson B. Good. Phillies when Mike began his career. Please welcome Rulie Carpenter. He was the farm director when Michael Jack signed with the Phillies, later became a great general manager and manager of the Phils, the Pope, Paul Owens. Over the course of Mike's career, a lot of coaches have had an impact on his success. Several of them are here tonight. His former batting instructor, Billy DeMar. The man for whom they named the machine because he threw a lot of extra batting practice for Mike, Irish Mike Ryan. Worked countless hours for Mike offensively and defensively. Former Phillies coach, now with the Atlanta Braves, Bobby Wine. A teammate of Mike's and later a coach, a great defensive third baseman in his own right, John Vukovich. A teammate of Mike's in his first 3 years in baseball, now a broadcaster for ESPN, the former Phil, Bill Robinson. A man who managed Mike in the minors, was a catcher for the Whiz Kids of the Philadelphia Phillies, the great Andy Semenik. If you would, we ask you to turn your attention to Fanavision for a tribute from another third baseman drafted on the second round in 1971. He plays in the other league, but he's a close friend of Mike's.
Hi, Mike. This is George Brett. You remember me? I play for Kansas City. Still playing for Kansas City. I hope you're enjoying life after baseball, and I just hope you turn out to be as good as an announcer as you were a baseball player. It was great playing against you in the 80 World Series and all those All-Star games, and I'm looking forward to getting you on the golf course this spring, or this winter in Palm Springs. Good luck.
When you play as many years as Mike did, you're going to spend some time in the trainer's room and you're going to have some injuries. The man who helped keep Mike in one piece and bring him on the field game in and game out for his Hall of Fame career, Phillies trainers Don Seager and Jeff Cooper. Our next guest was Mike's manager from 1973 to 1979. His 594 wins ranked second in club history only to Gene Mauch. Would you welcome, please, former Phillies manager Danny Ozar. Another manager instrumental in Mike's career was a big guy who took over the club in 1979, led them to the world championship in 1980, Dallas Green. Over the course of a player's career, you often find a teammate or two who provided inspiration and guidance. The first player to have an impact on Mike was a man who brought to the Phillies the "Yes, we can" attitude. Second baseman, Dave Cash. He returned to Philadelphia in 1975 and helped lead the team to the division title the following year. Another player who had a great impact on Mike's career. He looks like he can still play. Dick Allen. Once again, let's turn our attention to Fanavision for another video presentation from a former teammate who will be inducted into the Hall of Fame this year.
Mike, you had a great career. I admired you both as an opponent and as a teammate. Congratulations on them retiring your number. It's well deserved, and see you in the Hall of Fame.
A good friend of Mike's and an unsung member of the great Phillies team, including the World Championship team. The second best pinch hitter in baseball history. Would you welcome Greg Gross? One of the strengths of the great Phillies teams of the 70s was defense. We all know Mike won 10 gold gloves. This next guest was the best defensive shortstop in the league. What a combination on the left side. Mike Schmidt and Larry Boa. The greatest 1-2 home run punch for one Phillies season came in 1977. Mike hit 38 that year. The big left-hander belted 39. Welcome back, the Bull, Greg Luzinski. Once again, we direct your attention to Panavision for a special presentation by a member of that 1980 World Championship team who cannot be here tonight.
Hi, Mike. I just want to take this opportunity to congratulate you on having your uniform number retired tonight. I'm really sorry I couldn't be there, but somebody's got to work. I think it's fantastic what you accomplished in your career, and when I think back, playing with you is one of the highlights of my career. To think back in 1970 when you joined us in Reading and we started out together, I would have never thought that there would be a time when I'd be congratulating you on this fantastic achievement. You were the best I ever saw, and it was an honor for me to play with you. I'm sorry I can't be there tonight, but I care about you a lot.
Bob Boone. One scene Phillies fans will never forget happened in the final out, right after the final out of the World Series, when Tug McGraw was facing Willie Wilson, struck him out. Mike Schmidt leaped into the arms of Phillies ace reliever Tug McGraw. Of 1980. Years ago, Mike lived in Voorhees, New Jersey. He was a neighbor of this teammate. They built a friendship which will last forever. The Secretary of Defense, prison broadcaster Gary Lee Maddox.
Yeah, see right there.
Another neighbor back then played a different professional sport. He too is a friend of Michael Jack's, an all-star with the 76ers, who coached in the NBA, currently a broadcaster with TNT. Welcome back to Philadelphia, Doug Collins. Also wore number 20 in his playing days. Once again, we ask you to turn your attention to Panavision for a tribute by another former teammate.
I think the greatest compliment I can give Mike Schmidt is just to look you in the eye and say he's the greatest player I ever played with. And he knows the kind of players I played with. And he's certainly is as good as any player I ever played against. And he knows the type of players I played against. I mean, we're talking about some Super Hall of Fame players. But as far as I'm concerned, as a teammate, Mike Schmidt could do more in a baseball uniform than anybody I ever played with. And I'm talking about guys who were MVPs, Morgan's, Benches, Perez's. I mean, guys like that. I mean, great players. I mean, guys I have the utmost respect for. But Mike Schmidt was just a dream to play with. I mean, Mike Schmidt won't come down the line for many, many years again. There's not too many Mike Schmidts out there. And I hope I get to go to his Hall of Fame induction, because just to be able to rub elbows with Mike for 5 years made my career worthwhile.
Michael Jack at 548 home runs. Only six others have hit more homers. Nobody hit more than our next guest. With 755 home runs, the greatest home run hitter of all time. Welcome, please, Hall of Famer, Hammer and Hank, Hank Aaron. Big welcome for all of Mike's guests here tonight. Once more, if you would turn your attention to Panavision for a special word of you.
Welcome back. Your dreams were your ticket out. Welcome back to that same old place that you left.
Tonight, a couple of telegrams arrived. I'd like to read them for you. Congratulations to you and your family. What a day you've earned for yourself. All the home runs, the great plays at third, the baseball talks over dinner, the golf outings, all Hall of Fame stuff. What an honor to have thrown the longest single you ever hit. I thank you for inviting me to participate in this day, and for many years of great memories, how lucky Philadelphia fans were to have seen it all. From Claude Osteen, pitching coach, Albuquerque. Another one reads, congratulations and thanks for the thrills you've given to all of us over the years. You are a class act. You have my best wishes. Please and God bless, Julius Irving. Well, Mike, we have quite a few gifts for you tonight on this memorable occasion. And coming first from the Atlanta Braves, we have a special presentation, a 5 years supply of golf balls. For that presentation, a member of the 1980 Phillies, Lonnie Smith, Phil Knuckles Negro, Dale Murphy. Our thanks to the Braves, Lonnie Smith, Dale Murphy, and Knuckles Negro. Our next gift presentation comes from the guys in the first base dugout, Mike's teammates until his retirement nearly a year ago. Presenting the gift, Phillies catcher, Darren Dalton. The Phillies players would like to present Donna with a gold pin designed in number 20, and made out of diamonds from the Phillies players. The Phillies would like to introduce the sponsor of Mike Schmidt commemorative booklet you received tonight, the sponsor Hi-Fi House and Panasonic. Presenting a Panasonic combination VCR and color monitor and a laptop word processor, Robbins, chairman of Hi-Fi House, and Ken Adelberg, president of Hi-Fi House. I'm going to have a rough time. Our thanks from Hi-Fi House and Panasonic, Saul Robbins and Ken Adelberg. And the Phillies have several gifts for Mike and his family, so I call now to the microphone the president of the Phils, Phil Giles. Phil?
Michael, for over 17 years and over 3,000 days, you presented us with the great gift of playing the game of baseball with style, grace, power, and dedication like no other third baseman in the history of our great game. We are very grateful for the pleasure and the thrills that you have brought to us, and it is now my pleasure to present to you from the Phillies organization, to you and your family, some special gifts. First of all, from the Chicagoland Processing Corporation is a limited minute edition of these Mike Schmidt coins, number 20 for you, number 1 for Jessica, and number 548 for Jonathan, representing the 548 home runs you hit in your glorious career. Secondly, for you, is this very unique, especially designed Waterford crystal with a number 20 etched on the neck and the base engraved saying Mike Schmidt, the greatest third baseman in baseball history. And for you, Donna, Jessica, and Jonathan, I have for all of you an all-expense-paid trip around the world. God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. And now Mike has a special gift he'd like to present as a surprise. Mike?
You want to unwrap that? Why don't you unwrap that? For all that you've meant to me, all the home run calls, all the special moments, that's right, all the good times we've had, for my nickname, I'd like to give you the first in a limited edition of Neroy Prince, especially to Harry Callis. Thanks for everything, Harry. I love you.
Oh, man, I didn't know this was coming. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Wow.
Wow. 51 years ago, the Yankees began a tradition which we are continuing tonight for the second straight year. In 1939, the Yankees retired the first uniform number of a player, number 4, worn by Lou Gehrig. The Phillies have had 3 numbers retired before tonight. Entering the stadium from right field in the 1929 Packard, the person whose number 36 was retired by the Phillies in 1962, Hall of Fame pitcher Robin Roberts. Eleven years ago, the Phillies retired a second number. Number 1, worn by my colleague, Whitey Ashburn, riding into the vet in a 1936 Auburn. And last year, number 32 was retired. That number worn by a great left-hand pitcher riding a 1956 Ford Thunderbird, 4-time Cy Young Award winning Steve Lefty Carlton. Number 1, Robin Roberts, number 36. Steve Lefty Carlton, number 32. To officially retire Michael Jack's number 20, please turn your attention to the left field bullpen, where the newest Veterans Stadium disc will be unveiled. Never again to be worn by a Phillies player, the retirement of number 20 worn by Michael Jack Schmidt. I'd like to bring Steve Carlton, Jessica, and Jonathan Schmidt to the mound. Jessica and Jonathan, and Lefty Carlton. For you, Jeff, Jessica, Steve has the last home uniform jersey worn by your dad. And for you, Jonathan, your dad's last road uniform he wore when he was introduced prior to last year's All-Star game. Ladies and gentlemen, number 20 has officially been retired. It's been quite a night. Next thing we look forward to for Michael Jack is 1995, when he will be inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame. Would you welcome, please, the best third baseman ever to play this game, Michael Jack Schmidt.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Harry.
I have a short message, if the wind and the weather will cooperate, for you tonight. It concerns those areas of my life that were most important to my success. I'd like to talk briefly about my faith, my family, my friendships, and about you, the fans. Each of us has our own definition of faith. I define my faith three ways. First, my faith in God. God is the source for all my strength, physical and mental. In 1977, God entered my life. My faith in Him provided a foundation for my life and my career. Second, my faith in myself. My confidence, my belief that I would always reach my goals if I worked hard enough, especially in the tough times. My third faith involves those around me, my family, my teammates, and yes, you, my fans. The effect of family on my career began with my mom and dad and my sister Sally back in Dayton, Ohio. They provided me with love, the freedom to develop my skills, a strong sense of values, and a high regard for education. I met my wife Donna in 1973, and we were married 6 months later. With her, I developed a strong sense of responsibility and the fulfillment that comes with sharing our love. I'm blessed with two wonderful children who require me to set a strong example. All kids need heroes, not only mine, but every young child. This is especially important now, when children are more vulnerable than during any period in our history. I hope I've touched kids in a positive way. To me, everyone who wears a uniform carries responsibility of becoming a positive role model. When I think about it, this is more important than any home run, any play, or any statistic.
All these fade with time. But being a positive role model, both on and off the field, help others become better human beings. I'm thankful to baseball for many things. Perhaps the most important thing are the friendships it has given me. Playing baseball involves living with other players day in and day out, getting to know them, to learn from them, to lean on them in tough times, to survive together. I feel blessed to have made so many true friends in my 17 years of wearing the Phillies uniform. The uniform of a first-class organization run throughout my career by two first-class men, Rulli Carpenter and Bill Giles. I'm proud to call them both my friends. At times, I admit, I can be a hard guy to get to know. This makes me even more grateful to those who invested their time and their trust to build a friendship with me. Each of you has my friendship forever. And finally, my fans. I want to tell you straight from the heart how I feel about you. And your influence on this game. As athletes, we're disciplined, we're focused, we're even tough. But I know of no athlete who is immune to fan reaction, positive or negative. Yes, you fans affect the game in a big way. Calling Philadelphia fans spectators hardly describes your impact. You people mold the spirit of a team. Your positive feedback is crucial as the Phillies fight to stay on top. You know, I'm often asked what I miss most about the game. It's tough to sort out all the wonderful memories and come up with a definite answer. But I can tell you this, I'll always miss the goosebumps that I got when you cheered me. I've collected 18 years of those goosebumps from my first hit back in 1972 to the welcome you gave me here tonight. That feeling can never be recreated, but that feeling will always be remembered. My dreams started on a small playground near my home, where I first learned how to hold a bat. My dreams came true here on this field. This game, baseball, is rich with strategy, talent, challenge, excitement, and yes, tradition. But most of all, this game of baseball creates a bond, an indescribable bond, a bond that brings all of us together. All of us not only teams, but families, friends, communities, and yes, even now, countries. At this very moment, I feel that bond, and it will always be with me. I don't know where life's going to lead, but the Phillies and Philadelphia will forever hold a very special place in my heart. Thank you all. God bless you. Thank you all.
Ladies and gentlemen, number 20 has officially been retired. Now to take a victory lap, give you a chance one more time to say thanks, Michael Jack. Mike will be riding around in a victory lap in the convertible for a farewell and a thanks from the fans. Michael Jack Schmidt.
Baseball also yet to come. The Atlanta Braves and Philadelphia Phillies. Mike will be joining us during the broadcast, although don't expect a guy on a night like tonight to be able to do his regular stint of six innings. Gary Maddox is going to fill in as usual as well, and we're hoping to have some of the special guests that made this evening special for Mike dropping by as well. So it should be a terrific night. It's already off to a magnificent start, and we hope to keep you right here for the rest of the evening. The weather looks like it's going to hold up. We'll keep our fingers crossed, and to get us into tonight's game, we're going to go back to our Prism Sports studios with Larry Rosen and our Prism Sports team.
All right, thanks very much, Jim Barnack. So Mike Schmidt has now joined Robin Roberts, Richie Ashburn, and Steve Carlton. The 114-year history of the Phillies, Michael Jack, now the fourth player to have his number retired. Early in his career, of course, Mike was known for his stoic, ultra-cool approach to the game. Tonight, as we've come to expect, the emotions came through. It began with a boyish bit of emotion when the Tugger was introduced. Tug McGraw, a reenactment of that great hug from 1980, the final out after the Willie Wilson strikeout. And Michael spoke of his own dreams.
My dreams started on a small playground near my home, where I first learned how to hold a bat. My dreams came true here
on this field. This game, baseball, is rich with strategy, talent, challenge, excitement, and yes, tradition. But most of all, this game of baseball creates a bond, an indescribable bond, a bond that brings all of us together.
In my 14 years of broadcasting in Philadelphia, I've interviewed presidents and a pope, superstars, and also Rands. No one, though, has proven to be as articulate, as sincere, and frankly as interesting as Michael Jack Schmidt, especially when he got Michael in lengthy, heartfelt interviews during his playing career. As part of tonight's tribute, we will share with you some of those moments, insights of Michael. We begin in 1985 as Mike spoke to the subject of his often difficult relationship with the Phillies fans.
The other night, I'm picking up one of the other infielder's gloves, and we're going out on the field in the middle of a ball game. Cubs were in town, and or the Reds, I forget which one it was, and right over the top of the dugout there, which are the hottest seats in the house, you got to figure they're season ticket holders and Philly fans, and there's a couple of little kids, maybe 5, 6 years old, 8, 9 tops, and they're kind of just slumped over the railing there on top of the dugout. And they're not even really looking at me. As a matter of fact, they don't even know I'm there. But the one kid is just uttering over and over, "Schmidt, you stink. Schmidt, you stink. Schmidt, you stink." And, you know, it's like somehow he has learned somewhere that that's what to say at the ballpark by listening to his father or, by hearing about that. That displeases me when I see people that I care about the most are the young people and what I can do to affect their lives. And when I see a 5-year-old kid slumped over the rail saying, Schmidt, you stink, over and over, like he's heard it so many times, you know, he's going to grow up with that kind of a feeling about Mike Schmidt, and that hurts me.
As with the fans, Michael Jack had a unique relationship with the media. By 1986, Schmidt's sophisticated understanding of the media was on display.
One thing that I've got going for me this year that I didn't last year, and that's quality statistics, quality performance on the field. And your media types tend to look at me more, look at me with more respect. The names that you mentioned, they come to me now in a respectful tone of voice, with respectful questions like, "Yeah, all along we knew you were the key to this team." And then, last year they would come to me with a, "Yeah, this guy's through" attitude. You know, you can tell in the tone of their voice or the way they approach and when they approach and the way they write about you, the fact that I'm going good means so much. You know what I mean? They take stock in what I have to say. A lot of times I think the media people in this town are a little jealous of the fact that I understand that. You come to talk to me, I know you're talking to me in the tone of voice, you're asking me the question, not you, but a Peter Pascarelli or a Bill Connor, somebody, Bill Brown, I know your approach to me is different now than it was last year at this time. Because I'm going good now and I was going bad last year. And there's a tendency to get on my bandwagon and get off my bandwagon, get back on it and get back off it. And there are very few people that don't fall into that category, that don't let that happen to them as professional media people. And I don't know what the hell any of what I just said has to do with your original question.
By 1988, Schmidt was no longer indestructible. His $13 million 6-year contract was about to expire with no new offer on the table.
How do you react to Mr. Giles saying we'll wait till the end of the year to talk about Mike Schmidt coming back next year?
I don't react to that. I think that's his, obviously, his right as owner of the ball club to say what he wants to say concerning a player, and that's all I am as a player. He wants to stay on the offensive side of any arguments that might incur regarding me or any player. And he has that right to say, maybe in a sense he thinks, as it was written, that it might make me a little more intense and make me want to play a little harder in the second half. It has nothing to do with that, but that's his right to say what he said.
You don't take it particularly seriously, do you?
I think if I want to play for the Phillies next year, I'll play, no matter what Bill Giles says.
And in his final spring training after rotator cuff surgery, Schmidt had come full circle. He had to prove himself, just like the rookie who had left Dayton, Ohio with two bad knees and a dream.
I'm employed by the Phillies and employed to play third base by the Philadelphia Phillies and do my job on this ball club. As long as I can do that, I'll be a Philadelphia Philly. But as soon as I'm incapable of fulfilling my obligation to this ball club, I'm going to have to find another job. It's just that simple. It's business. There is a place for loyalty in sports, but not between these white lines on the baseball field. And I am totally understanding of that and willing to play under those circumstances. That's the way the game should be played, and I've accepted the challenge to perform between these white lines for the Philadelphia Phillies as their third baseman. I may want to be their first baseman. I may want to be their manager. I may want to be their general manager. I may want to be the owner, but right now I'm the third baseman, and that has to be my main concern.
So the touching ceremonies are now history, some wonderful moments, Michael, speaking of the joy of family. The ironic moment from Pete Rose, who says, I hope I'm allowed to be in Cooperstown in the mid-90s, when Mike's inducted into the Hall of Fame, and Bob Boone saying, I remember him back at AA Reading, who would have thought 20 years later we'd be having a night like this. More with Mike, of course, later tonight. He'll spend the middle innings tonight in the broadcast booth. But coming up first, the business at hand, a look at tonight's game for the first-place Phillies and the Atlanta Braves. Tonight, two of the Phillies' first-round draft picks the last 6 years will go head-to-head.